Great. Okay. So welcome everyone to this session of today. Today we will talk about one of the projects that CircleWorks from the past year of school, AIL project, which is a complete framework for doing analysis of information leaks. So the project of the past few years evolved quite a lot. So today is really a session to refresh everyone about the new features, functionalities of AIL, including an introduction of what is all about and what is the goal of AIL. So I'm not alone here. I'm with Aurélien, Jean-Louis, and Sami that will talk and discuss during the workshop. As we are a small group today, don't hesitate to be active, ask questions, share ideas. People that are already using AIL, if you have any, I mean, even bug reports, things like that, we'll do a demo of the tools. Don't hesitate to share during the sessions. We are there to help. There is a HDoc document, which is basically an active document where people can even edit and modify the document. And then if you want to ask questions and so on, you can even add it in the document directly and make the document editable for everyone. So, first of all, we will talk about the different references that you can find and so on. So the main repository of the AIL project is on GitHub, is called AIL project. And within that organization, you have different software. One main component is obviously the AIL framework, which is really the core component of AIL. We will explain that during the session of today. What is AIL framework? What is the AIL project and so on? All the slides of the trainings are available online. On that repository, you have even the source. If you want to share those and even reuse them afterwards, you can do that. We have a dedicated online chat for people asking questions for AIL direct. Before really going into details about AIL, we would like to make a kind of, I would say, warning or recalls regarding the legal and ethical aspect of AIL. You'll see that we'll process a lot of data that are coming from leaks, sensitive sources, even illegal ones sometimes, and so on. So you have to be careful. For example, Jean-Louis will do a demo using the Conti leaks, which is quite interesting because it's really showing the capability of AIL and what you can do with it. But obviously, playing with leaks and so on might, I would say, raise some questions or even some legal aspect out of it. So the thing that is quite important here, it's a lot of person ask, if I operate AIL, what are the risks, what are the legal scope of it, and so on. And we did even some analysis on that. So it's quite important if you plan to operate an AIL instance for doing crawling, for doing analysis, investigations, and sharing back the information, you obviously fall into the GDPR regulations, especially that AIL is processing informations such as personal names, credit card number, things like that, password, and so on. So basically, you have to define a kind of legal ground for processing the personal data. And the legal ground depends on your organization, your processing activities, and so on. From the CCIRT network perspective, it's quite straightforward because you basically have a kind of legal framework existing under the NIS directive, which basically allow the organizations to operate, but you have to look at the GDPR and so on. So we have a document, we can share it in the chat too. This document is basically the document referencing the GDPR and how AIL could fit there. So it's something that we already discussed quite a lot, and we know many CCIRT are operating AIL under that kind of regulations actually. So that's I think something quite important, and it makes a lot of sense if you have a legal advisor within your organizations to be sure that you are basically in line. Thanks Aurélien for sharing the link in the chat. So you can have a look at this one and even share it with your legal advisor. So what is the legal ground of operating AIL? There's usually a very, I think, significant question is basically you need to the consent of the data subject. But when you are processing leak, you obviously don't get the consent. So it's often impossible or even illogical to obtain the consent of the victims to get that. Nevertheless, You are kind of a legal obligation, so we have a legitimate interest to operate it, to basically protect the users and notify them about leaks and so on. So you see, you have a kind of paradox here, which is basically the legitimate use case for us for the CSIRT, which is the famous Recital 49 from the GDPR, where basically we need to process the data to inform and protect at the end potential victims and users that might have a leak in the wild. So thing that you have to keep in mind too, and we know that some users are maybe having different ethics or the ethical standards are different between even countries and it's cultural and so on. But what we basically ask for, because AIL is quite a powerful tool, you can really process the data, extract a lot of things like, I don't know, for example, credit card numbers, account of specific services and things like that. So really the stuff for us is really this AIL is used for public goods and especially to improve incident response. If you are curious about that, about the ethics and so on, there is a very good one about the ethics first from first.org and the code of ethics from computing machinery, which is quite good too. So it's a kind of good reference in the case. So that means during this workshop, we'll try to follow that ethics. If you have any question regarding that aspect and so on, don't hesitate to shout and even stop us and we can discuss about it. Okay, so this was kind of a disclaimer first, to be sure on that. During the sessions, we will do some demo and AIL is operating using real data. So indeed, we might see some leak of information and so on during those kind of demonstration and investigations. So first of all, it's something that I think is quite important, and we have a lot of discussion about what is the dark web, the deep web, and so on. We do in the workshop the definitions and we describe it. So for example, if we talk about the deep web, which is I think the most appropriate definitions of the invisible web or at least the non-indexed web, is basically everything that is not indexed by Google. Even if you can already find a lot of information from Google perspective, for example, or from a search index perspective, a lot of things are not indexed. If we just take GitHub, for example, don't expect Google to index every single source code in GitHub. So very often what we are doing is basically ending up on the search engine of GitHub to find back specific information. And that's the thing that is quite important there. It's where you collect the information and what we can to crawl, usually things that are not known or at least officially indexed. And a lot of crawling activities might need specific access. And we will talk about that in the AIL workshop. For example, we have feeders for Telegrams, for Discord, for ActivityPub, and so on. And in those cases, you need to have API access, usernames, account, even phone number associated to your account, to the access to the data. So it's not always that this content is publicly accessible, but very often this content is basically hidden. So that's why we call it deep web, or at least this information that is not really accessible directly. In some cases, and Aurélien might talk about it later, but we did, for example, a specific services within AIL called CookieJar, which allow us to, for example, crawl website where you have an access to. So that means as a browser, as a user, you have access with your browser and you can extract the cookies to basically ask AIL to do that. And that's one way to crawl data directly. So you can crawl anything you like with AIL, obviously, but you might have sources that are basically completely public. Some are coming from the deep web. And obviously, a large portion is basically not accessible directly from well-known search engines, so that need to be indexed in some way. Now, the question of darknet, because you have the confusion of the deep web and dark web. So we assume for us, darknet is basically just the overlay network. So for example, Tor is a darknet. So that means you basically have an overlay onion routing, which is on top of internet and needs specific software to access to that network. That's the case for Tor, I2P, Freenet. So for example, AIL is supporting right now Tor out of the box. We have some plan to support I2P out of the box too, and some additional one.
So just a side note, because Tor, I2P, and Freenet are the historical one, but now you have new ones like Nîmes, for instance, or there's also a French one which is called Snowpack, I think. And so those things, maybe later on we'll look into it. But you will have a lot of new ones, because actually the way they work is that they give some reward with some kind of coins. So Nîmes now has a very big network with a lot of nodes because of that. So it may become interesting in the future. That's it. Side note.
No, very good point indeed. Especially the dark nets are evolving. I mean, maybe some of you are very, very familiar with GNUnet, which was a network accessible some years ago, which is basically kind of dead nowadays. But it means that it's evolving. And indeed, the Nîmes case is an interesting one where people are basically paid for operating the nodes. So there's kind of incentive to operate those nodes. So that's growing. So, and we'll talk about that too in Ale. What we call the Splash Manager and the system to access such kind of darknet is independent from the tool itself doing crawling. So that means we can plug additional one in the futures to support such kind of things. Very good point, Jean-Louis, thank you. There are something that is interesting too, and not everything through the darknets are illegitimate. So you might have legitimate use cases of, and that's quite important, because when you are crawling data from those kind of networks, you need to differentiate legitimate from illegitimate usage. And depending of your scope, the legitimate usage might be depending of your own organizations and what you are doing with data. So keep that in mind. Obviously, there are a lot of illegal or at least criminal usage of such networks, but they are also legitimate use case. That's quite important too. We won't go too much into theory of collections and so on, but basically it's always the same model of collections. And you see that in Ale is taking place in a lot of those steps. So usually when you do collection and analysis of information that you collect from different sources, you obviously have to have a plan that makes a lot of sense. You need to plan what you want to collect at how much regular intervals and so on. I'll take an example. If you want to collect information from GitHub, you might have different way of collecting that, and you have to evaluate the different models of collecting. Do you want to do full collection? Do you want to collect, for example, the GitHub archive? Do you want to collect a specific set of data from GitHub? Do you want to search per keyword or specific value? So you see that the planning is important, because it basically deduces what kind of information will be seen in Ale and analyzed and so on. So the planning aspect is really important. Then you have the collect aspect. It's all you collect. And this one is, I think, quite important. During this workshop, we have like around 20 slides which are about the different sources that you can have from Ale and how you can extend it. As we mentioned, we will show you different ways of doing it, but we have already a set of plugins for different kinds of tools, from Twitter to Discord, Telegram, generic JSONs, even RSS or Atom. So that's the way of the collecting. And then you have the processing and analyzing, which are, I think, usually kind of overlapping, but it's usually the duplication and so on that are more into the processing activities. And then you have the analyzing, where it's more like finding specific patterns, doing semantic analysis of the data and so on, and maybe even doing manual analysis. We will show to you a new functionality that we have in Ale called the investigations, where it be kind of MISP. You can really create a kind of bundles of objects together that are linked to a specific investigations. And that's really the analyzing part. So you can have automatic analyzing, which helps the support of manual analysis later. And you'll see that we try to simplify or at least reduce the fatigue of the analyst by having more automatic models for detection and so on. We'll show you in the different way of doing it. And then the disseminations, which is, I think, super important for the CSIRT network and other networks like the CSIRT, is if you find something that is of interest from one of your partners or you need to notify someone, you need to have connectors for doing that. And Ale has synchronization mechanisms, so you can synchronize between Ale instances, or you can even, for example, export it into MISP as an event. You can export it into the Hive and so on, and you have different ways of doing that. So it's really the dissemination aspect. So always keep in mind, it sounds to be a bit kind of sequential actions, but it's not always the case when you do collections. You can, for example, do some collections, start to do processing, and you see that you are missing some element. Then you go back to planning, see where you can get the sources and so on. Good example, Twitter. We have a Twitter feeder, which is basically not using the API, which is very nice because that means you don't need any traces. You basically are not limited to the API request and so on. You don't have to pay for the access, which is interesting, but this has some limitations. So sometimes you might need to have a pay access. So after processing, you might say, okay, I'm missing data and I need to have an additional collection mechanism, and you plan it again. So that's quite important. It looks like a bit, I would say, serialized. But at the end, it's something that is basically, a continuous process when you are doing collections over time. So don't hesitate if you have any question and so on. I saw that Jean-Louis already pasted in the chat other darknet that are currently used. It's interesting because those one, at least for CCIRT, might be in the future interesting to monitor. So and that's the planning and the collection activities might be evolving within a CCIRT network to collect those kind of informations. And one of the plans maybe on the future is to share such kind of collections among different teams. So for example, one team is more expert into a collection from Tor, and maybe one is more expert in collecting in I2P. And then you can merge data into two L instances to get such kind of data. So that's basically the theoretical approach of the life cycle of collection and analysis. But obviously, this can change a bit, or you can have overlapping boxes depending there on the dissemination aspect and so on, for example.
Yeah, just a side note regarding this diagram. So we have this planning one, which is really important in L, because if you can already plan those items and things you want to look for whenever you're processing the data, it will really speed up the time of detection. But one thing that is not represented in this diagram is the fact that AL also has the capacity to reprocess whatever has been already processed once. Meaning that if later on you discover that, for example, some keywords were missing in your planning phase, you can still add them and then ask the software to reprocess everything. So that you can also have some kind of loop between the analyzing phase and the planning phase.
Yeah, thanks. It's a very good point indeed. Okay, just think that we before going into deep dive into L and how it works, we wanted to basically talk about the different aspect of what is the difference between, I would say, a statical, classical search engine where you collect pages and then you do indexings versus what L is doing. So first, if you go into the search engine aspect, you have a lot of challenges that you need to tackle. And I mean, some of the well-known companies doing search engine try to tackle that. They don't even always succeed, but it's very difficult. So first of all, it's basically crawling web pages, which sounds a bit obvious, but it's difficult because, for example, one of the most common problems is basically how do you bootstrap the URLs? Where do you find those websites? So that's for large search engine is already existing. So they provide list of existing websites and they basically use that as a bootstrap. But think about, for example, Tor, if you need to find onion addresses and so on, you basically need to know in advance all those onion addresses to crawl. And we will go into detail about that, or we do it in AL, but it's important. So it's basically when you crawl data, it's basically finding those websites. Now, if you crawl the website, you have plenty of technical problems like timeout, access, and so on. And I will not mention to you, but if you look at the current situations, you might have some difficulties to reach out, for example, some Russian websites today. So crawling them might be difficult, get those files and so on, it make a lot of difficulties. Then you have another thing is, don't expect that all web pages have structured data or structured pages, even if it's sometimes using HTML, not always, and that's another important point. There are a lot of data is basically unstructured. You basically have forums containing like structure of data, containing into JavaScript the data itself. So it's usually very difficult to make sense of all the data. A lot of information that is there too is unstructured in a way that you might have, for example, shared data between, I don't know, if you take a Git, for example, you might have, for example, a dump of a database into a Git repository at the same time you have a chat log there. And for leaks of data, it's quite interesting. we can show, for example, the Conti leak, which is quite interesting because this one is basically a leak of chat sessions. And you see that this kind of data contain unstructured information, PGP keys, URL, things like that. So you need to take that. And the thing is, you want to index it. So that's what is a search engine is doing is basically indexing. L is going a bit further than that, is to detect patterns and structure there to basically make the information accessible, to search into it, to being tagged and so on. So that's really the important aspect. And one of the most important aspects is correlations. We will show you some example today of how interesting it is to have correlations. If you start to have a Bitcoin address appearing on a website and you have it in the chat logs from a ransomware group, and then you start to see that there is a correlation between those two this website and this chat log, it might give a lot of insight. So the correlation aspect of specific indicators might be very interesting. We will show you some examples with Telegram and others. Another thing that is important is for Tor, it's usually difficult to find the services. They are up and down at various intervals. Don't expect them to be accessible on a regular basis, not like I would say commercial website where you basically have an uptime and so on. So it's very challenging sometimes to crawl those Tor addresses. Tor addresses might change over time due to the owner losing keys, due to takeover, takedowns. You might have other issues like the Tor addresses evolve over time too. So recently they do a switch over to new version of the Tor addresses. So a lot of operators had to change the addresses, but that means for us monitoring, you had to keep track of what has been changed and so on. So it might be very interesting. Another thing that is quite interesting too is a lot of data that you might crawl are not in HTML format, but you might have plain text, you might have binary files, you might have specific base64 encoded files, things like that. We'll show you what we do with that. It's quite complex. Then last but not least, don't underestimate the capacity of bandwidth, storage, and computing power to do the processing. So for us, we have dedicated machine for crawling Tor and so on. We are capable of crawling completely Tor on a daily basis because it's still not so large. But if you store screenshots and stuff like that, you might end up with a lot of storage being used. I don't know if someone wants to add something there. Oh, okay, perfect. Then when you are collecting this kind of data, you need to process the data. Thing that is quite important too, you might have data that are easy to process, existing metadata. So when you process an API from Twitter, for example, you have already a lot of metadata, locations, username, things like that. You have other things that you can query and basically give you an API response with complete structure information and so on. So that's quite interesting there. Those data are structures, easy to process. So don't forget about those ones. And you see that, for example, for RSS or atoms, those ones are already well structured, times-wise and so on. And that could help a lot when you do the analysis. Another thing that is quite interesting is a lot of data that is shared are providing what we call cryptographic evidences. So if someone is sending, for example, a signed message, it's showing off the possession of a private key. So that means it's this user, or at least sharing this kind of signatures, is in possession of the specific private keys, which is interesting because when you have a signature, you basically have a key ID. And if you have a key ID, you can find back the user email addresses associated to it. And that's what we do in AIL. We extract, for example, all OpenPGP messages, not only the PGP key itself, but the signatures, encrypted messages too. And even an encrypted message contains the key ID, and then you can start to see correlations between those key ID together. So that's quite interesting. A lot of metadata are basically shared, even sometimes the user using such kind of things doesn't know. Another thing that is interesting, for example, we will show you some example with Bitcoin. When someone is doing a transaction on Bitcoins, we have some knowledge about who owns which addresses, and obviously we basically knows who owns this specific wallets, for example. And in AIL, we have an automatic detection, so we can even query directly the blockchain to find out if those related chain has been used. So it's giving a kind of proof that, for example, this website has received money for example, from these users that are basically on Pastebin sharing something else. That's quite interesting to see those kind of things. And you can really pivot from that. We'll show you some examples. It's really super easy. And a lot of adversaries doesn't even know about that, that when they start to even send encrypted messages, they start to share metadata, which is really a nice source of data for doing correlations. Okay, so that's kind of a quick introduction of dark web monitoring and so on. Now we go more into detail about Ale and what we want to do with Ale and what was the original design objective of Ale. So for us, it's as a third, it was always difficult to basically find out things that are related about an incident or potential leak from a specific citizen in a country in an easy way. So what we wanted to do is to basically have an open source tool to monitor web pages, Pasty's website, so like Pastebin, Ghostbin, whatever, forums, and obviously hidden services from Tor. And really the session that we want to do today is really to show to you what was and what were all different challenges for the design of the Ale framework. And really the idea here is to give you some idea about collection mechanism, sources, and how to extend that. Because really, Ale is a powerful tool. Maybe you need some hours or days to start to dig into it, but you have the capabilities to basically change completely the tool for doing your processing. And you'll see that to create modules and so on is pretty straightforward. And that's really the idea of the session of today, how to use it, how to install Ale. You'll see it's super straightforward. And especially the thing that we want to do today is to show you how to support an investigations using the Ale framework, including the complete life cycle of what to do with information, dispatching it, how to analyze it, how to basically classify all the information into an investigation and things like that. So that's really the session of today. So don't hesitate to shout questions during the sessions. We are a small team today. It will be recorded. So if you want to afterwards share the session with other team members and so on, don't hesitate to do it. That's really the goal of the session of today. So maybe a bit of history of the Ale framework. So the project is not so young, not so old, I would say. It started in 2014 as an internship project. So we wanted to evaluate the feasibility of having a tool for analysis structure and unstructured information to find leaks. That was really the initial goal of Ale. And in 2019, it's an open source project that we were maintained and released as Circle in 2019. And in 2020, as the project became more used and we had more contributions, it became a standalone project like we do for all other projects like D4 project, MISP, and so on. Nowadays, it's called Ale project. So the Ale project is basically the host organizations, which is virtual organizations, basically hosting all the different projects and so on, which is the frameworks, the feeder, the splash manager, documentation, and so on. So same model as MISP, not as big as MISP, but really the goal is to have all the supporting tools for people doing leak analysis and leak findings. So now, what are the different use cases of Ale? And I think maybe the first one, and I think the most common one is really this one, the easiest one from Ale, is to check if something has been leaked, especially mail, passwords, or any other sensitive information. We will show to you the different way of tracking such kind of thing in Ale. So it's starting from very small and simple terms tracking up to very complex YARA rules. So you'll see that in Ale that you can have, I would say, four or five different ways of basically tracking terms. You can have regular expressions, you can have specific rules, and we have even a specific library of predefined YARA rules to find interesting things. And obviously, another thing that is interesting is the tools can be used to automatically detect specific, I would say, patterns of reconnaissance tool. For example, Nmap, other tools have some common output. And you'll see that a lot of attackers and adversaries are sharing such kind of information. So it's really one of the most common usage of Ale is to find out, okay, is there anyone searching for my infrastructures on specific forums and so on. Then you can even feed data into ELS, which is sometimes very large data set. For example, you discover a huge leak, torrent leak from a company. So I don't know, take an example like Samsung, for example, it's a recent one. It's multiple gigabytes of data, but you want to know if there is no, I would say, I don't know, personal information from your organization that are part of this leak. And you have a way in MISP to, in ELS to push that information, find out those leaks, and then, for example, to share it back in MISP if you want, with other members to discover and say that, okay, they have to deal with it, for example, reset password or notify the potential victims. And one of the most common users is to monitor and crawl website. It could be a malicious website, but it could be legitimate one from your own organization to be sure that they are not misconfigured, does not contain any you know, spam insights, injections, or exploits, which was, I think, a very common case some years ago with ExploitKit. Nowadays, it's going a bit, I would say, lower, but it's still useful for a lot of things like, for example, misconfigurations and so on. I know some organizations using ELS to find out S3 assets on their own website to be sure that there is no leak of S3 materials from Amazon, for example. So for cert and law enforcement is usually the classical things. So what kind of leak that we can detect is email and password, obviously leak database. This morning, I was looking with my colleague to find out some example. And again, on a daily basis, you have different leaks from different sources and so on. Obviously, some other leaks are becoming more and more important, especially that they have a kind of, I would say, value, commercial values for cloud services, for example, like Amazon services, Google, whatever. So if you find those kind of leaks, people can abuse it, use it, and even make some, I would say, financial damage sometimes. So that's quite important. Again, we can find leaks of keys, key materials, X509 certificate, and so on. And you see that, again, it's still a very common issue. You have seen for the recent NVIDIA leaks, the certificate were used by malware to sign, obviously, malicious software or specific tools they used. So it's super important there to find out if it's a way to collect such kind of information. There's a question, maybe? No, I think someone is unmuted. Okay. Another thing that is quite useful of using ELS, it's, for example, to feed existing system. So for example, we feed our passive DNS database from ELS. So that means we extract potential domain names, host name, and so on from existing website that we crawl, Tor, whatever, and automatically we feed the passive DNS. So it's quite interesting for feeding systems. For example, what thing that we are doing too is we are extracting CVE numbers from a lot of unstructured informations, and it's giving a lot of details about what are the most active proof of concept for exploit and so on. So it's another way of basically finding out, is it something that I need to patch urgently? Because if the attacker is already using it, it's super important. So a thing that you can do with ELS is to find out what are the most active things.
And also to find proof of concept code sometimes. Because there are, for instance, some YARA rules we use that are for the headers of the POC that you can find online. And if you search just for the headers, like CVE 20-something, then you may find some POC that you didn't know about. So sometimes it's very interesting to have a fresh POC for a CVE.
Yeah, it's giving real insight of what is really used by the attackers. And if you have a POC that you, okay, maybe we should really be more careful, for example, as a cert, if we have any exposed device, for example, in our infrastructures, indeed. So that's... additional things. So, for example, what we are doing in ELS too, which can be a support of thirds, are obviously the website monitoring. Not only monitoring from, I would say, as a passive way of doing it, but really as an active way to figure out what are doing the adversaries. So, for example, we are monitoring various websites about DDoS booter. So, those DDoS websites are on Tor, even on internet. And they give services to DDoS services. And for us, it's interesting to see how those services are used, how large those kind of botnets are used, what is the cost for an attacker of using it, do they have different way of basically attacking, gathering some information about the techniques they use. So for us, it was quite important. Another thing that we are doing, and we have some example for today, is to extract from website and forms information that is shared by attackers, or for example, specific pivot point on compromised website. For example, web shell, specific malware encoded on Base64 on a website, first layer of payload delivery for a malware, thing that you can really detect automatically. Thing that which is quite interesting for us too, is to monitor the reconnaissance tool, like for example, SQL map, where we see what are of interest for the attacker, like for example, SQL injection, things like that. So we see for example, if you are target, and you see, for example, for the past days, a lot of information that is shared, for example, are targets on Russian and Ukrainian websites. So you see that, you see the trend of that. Some weeks ago, it was more like, we say, generic website worldwide, but you see a trend that the attackers are basically focusing on specific countries and so on nowadays. Thing that is important is for us, it's to have a integration with MISP and other tools. The idea being is basically when you detect something in AIL, you can automatically generate a complete MISP event and share it back with your members and so on, which is, I think, for us, the ultimate goal is to share back the information so that people can take measures and limiting those kind of things. Thing that we are doing too, and maybe we can talk about later, but for example, we have specific monitoring for name of companies. So to be proactively searching for name of companies, especially when you are monitoring, for example, the Tor hidden services of a ransomware group, you want to be really on the edge when a group of attackers is starting to share information, since they mention a company names. You don't want to be late, especially that if you have to contact a company to prepare or to inform them about the leak, early it is, and it's better for them to basically handle the case and do the final notifications to their users and so on. Okay, so what are the source of leaks and so on? And I'll do quickly on that. It's just to show you a kind of issue that we have seen. If you just look on GitHub, for example, and you search for remove password, you'll see you have a lot of Git commits that are basically removing passwords. And obviously, those passwords very often are not reset. So meaning if you have access to the Git changelog, people are using it and so on. We have seen users and attackers that are using it afterwards to basically gain credits on some cloud services, things like that. So it's very common. And you see that's quite important. So one of the sources of leaks, and we are monitoring that one, for example, it's Gist on GitHub, which is a very simple way to share text online. It's used by many people, by programmers, legitimate users, but very often they leak additional information. But they are not the only one using it. Jean-Louis was mentioning POC, so proof of concept exploit. Very often those POC are available on Gist, on GitHub, so you see that they are publishing it there and they are making it accessible to everyone. So it's a big issue. So if you are able to monitor that, it's a very interesting thing. Then you have a lot of more things like dump of information, proof of owning data, which is very often by ransomware groups or some adversaries, showing off that they have the data, which is an interesting case there because we can detect that they are showing off and then we can take appropriate actions on the data. So the thing is, just an example of PACE, you see that it's usually mixed of data and that's completely unstructured. You might have programming language, you might have, I would say, natural language, you might have chat, you might have mixed data, you might have HTML pages. So keep that in mind. We'll just take the example of PACE, but it's everything that we collect can be in different formats. And AIL is basically, I would say, agnostic on the format itself. It's basically looking at the different pattern that he knows and so on, but he won't go into details about analyzing a specific format and so on, especially that a lot of formats are even broken. If you look at even HTML pages, around 70 or 80% of the website are not even validating the standard HTML specifications. So you cannot expect to have valid data when crawling the internet. So the question that you might ask, and how is it possible that you have so many leaks accessible publicly and so on. And there are plenty of reasons. The first one is obviously is not the least one, I would say, the economical interest. Adversaries need to sell their services. They need to show off what they have. So it's a classical. It's like a shop. I mean, a shop is making maybe an advertising, or they are doing a website. They have an account on Facebook to, selling their services. But it's the same for the attackers. They need to reach out to their customer, and that's exactly something that is interesting, because when they do that, they basically share a lot of details. If they share a PGP key, then you get a lot of details about this PGP key and so on directly there. In addition to that, and this one is, I would say, the most well-known model is the ransom model, where a lot of people are leaking information to put publicly pressures on the victim side. So that means they ransom and they want to ransom the users. And one way to do it is basically to make pressures on the victims by showing off that they have a leak, and this leak of information might end up on the internet at some point in time. So it's really a ransom model. They are blackmailing them and expecting them to basically pay the different ransom. Another thing that is basically interesting is the, I would say, political motives, which is basically another way of showing off, but where the final motive is not really the economical aspect, it's more like it's a matter of politics. So groups like Anonymous, others, and so on, like to do that. They do show off, and they share a lot of information. But by showing off, they share information about their own infrastructures, but they share a lot of details about their victims. So it's quite interesting there. Another thing to not underestimate is a lot of sources of information is coming from collaboration itself. Maybe some of you are familiar with some forums. There are a lot of forums for buying and exchanging leaks of data. I mean, for example, if you know Red Forums, which has been recently seized by the FBI, this one was one of the most well-known forums where people were sharing and proposing buying data and so on. So it's really a way for them to collaborate. For example, some are even sharing their pre-reconnaissance to team members and so on kind of publicly or at least not indexed website. Another way to it, it's basically they are using even some of the public website to exfiltrate information. So it's not uncommon to see, for example, malware using GitHub, malware using Twitter for exchanging informations or exfiltrating informations. We have seen, for example, pasties on specific websites where complete malware have doing the keylogging on those kind of websites, which is interesting because it's basically a way for them to reuse public and free infrastructures for their own systems. And obviously, mistake and errors, which is not a small one, but a lot of people are leaking credentials or database, things like that, by just debugging and sharing those kind of debug files. So maybe something that is quite interesting is, are those leaks frequent? And they are. Obviously, they are, and we have to deal with this as a CSIRT. So obviously, what do we do with this? Is basically, we are contacting the victims or the organizations to mention about those leaks so that they can take additional measures. But another thing that is interesting is, for us, it's a way to really show that this is a reality behind the scene, that the leaks are existing. And if you have media asking about, oh, you talk about those leaks, but are those real? But we have metrics. I mean, on a daily basis, if you see as the number of leaks that we can find, it's quite impressive. And it, again, it's just the surface of what has been compromised and accessible. So it's really important for us to use that not only to see the reality, but to evaluate the real market of it for the criminals and so on. And for us, it's interesting because it's a source of threat intelligence for software vulnerabilities. For example, Jean-Louis was mentioning POC. Sometimes you have a CV, you don't exactly know if it's exploited, but if it's popping up into a forums, you start to have like additional evidences that is really used by an attacker and so on. So it's quite important. And obviously, if you have a lot of leaks, you want to do that automatically. And that's where AL is basically playing a role. I will not go into detail in that, but if you're interested into statistics and so on, we have a document, so we have the TR46 that we regularly update. Those ones are only the leaks that are at least touching constituents in Luxembourg, but are sometimes part of a bigger leak. You see that we regularly update that. It's quite interesting. And Aurélien just shared the link in the chat. It's really showing the activities. just as an example, it's how many pasties that we are collecting there. So for example, it's not uncommon to collect more like 20 million pasties, but it depends on the leaks. And you see that on a daily basis, you might have like bigger leaks of gigabytes of data. So again, going back to the planning aspect of collections, you might sometimes need to reduce your sources to just focus on what is interesting for you. Okay. Someone else wants to add something? Okay. So what is the current capabilities of Ale? And now we can start to dig into more Ale framework and software. So first of all, it's for us, it's very important that this system is completely extendable. A lot of contributions that we receive for Ale are basically new analysis modules. And nowadays, you can even write modules in less than 50 lines of Python. And I think 50 lines is even a lot. In one of the slides, we'll show you the skeleton. The skeleton is like 6 lines of Python. You can really create your own modules. And the nice thing with Ale, you don't have to take care about multiprocessing, handling about large volume of data, and so on. Is Ale framework doing it for you? You can start multiple processes and so on. If you write a simple script to process it, you can have like multiple processes that are running it and so on. So automatically, Ale will take care of that. Same with the concurrent data input. If you have, for example, I don't know, Twitter crawling, Tor crawling, and so on, deduplication and so on is handled by Ale. You don't have to take care about that. As long as you're able to push the data, that's it. And it's handled like that for Ale. Same with the Tor crawler, so which is really separated from Ale, but the crawling aspect, which is handling the cookies authentication and so on, are capabilities that are building in Ale. So you basically have a crawler there. It's just a specific sub-project if you want to have the full crawler manager. But it's really what Ale is capable of doing. So what are the current features? And maybe in the demo, we'll see it. But obviously, we are able to extract credit card numbers, credentials, phone numbers, and many other things that are considered as being leak of information. We are automatically extracting host names. It's used for various things like localizations of the data itself, but it helps to feed, for example, passive DNS and so on. We have a system for finding duplicates, and it's really focusing on the credential leaks, especially when we receive a leak. We want to know if this leak is known, already shared by another group. Is it an old leak? Is it a new one? So for us, it's quite important. Things that are interesting and part of the system is you can just do some automatic submissions of anything that is coming into Ale toward MISP or Beehive through the tagging system. So we have an automatic tagging system and so on. Then you have the ability to search for terms, set regular expressions, Yara tracking, and so on. You see that it's quite interesting. You can see over time what are the occurrences, find back the thing that you are looking at. You really have to see Ale as a streaming box, so as a analyzing box of stream data. So you stream data inside Ale and automatically we'll do all those processing. You can submit in two different ways through the user interface. You can even submit raw archive, things like that. And you can even use different feeders for putting data there. Like for example, if you have a huge leak, for example, on multiple gigabytes and so on, you have even a specific feeder for that. We have an automatic correlation system for PGP, cryptocurrencies, specific decoded values, usernames, for example, Telegram username, things like that, Twitter, and many more other functionalities, but we'll go more into detail that in that aspect. For the time tracker, it's usually the one that is the most used in Ale. It's really the way to search and monitor for specific keywords. So you can search for terms, which is, I think, very basic. You search for specific words. But you can have a track set, which are basically a set of words that you want, and you have to have a set of minimal words matching that specific set. So it's interesting when you have more complex rule set. You have obviously a tracker with full regular expressions and with Yara rules. Yara rules are exactly the same that you use for virus total, for example, or for malware reversing. But you can use it for text files, for binary files in Ale. And we have libraries of already existing rules for finding, for example, common leak of informations, specific things that are linked, for example, for Python code that are used for exploitations, PHP code for that, and many others. We'll show some examples there. So if you look at the term trackers, so we'll go into detail on that, but for example, this one is regular expressions. You see when it has been added, and you see the evolution over times of the different terms, how many times you have it, and then you can search for the tracked items. So basically an item is an object that you collect, and then you have the one that are matching, and you can basically extract those ones. Same with Yara, you can search for specific things. So for example, this one is a specific rules for looking for visual basic, but especially with specific functions. So you can search, for example, for create object, searching for the address of function in Windows and things like that. And if you have some hits there, so if you have at least five of them that are matching, you can find those ones. So for us, it's interesting. You can find PowerShell, VBScript, and so on from actual attackers finding specific things. And you can build your own rules with that. We come with a set of rules by default, but that's how it works. So from a practical point, how can you do that? You basically create and specify your tracker. You can have email notifications, so you can even have WebSocket notifications, and you select your tracker type, and then you can add a specific things. We have a specific modules, and this one is quite extensive. So these tools can recognize more than 94 reconnaissance tools that are used by attackers, Metasploit, Nmap, DNS scan, whatever. They are there, and then you can really find out a lot of information shared by the attackers. I think I have one or two examples afterwards. It's quite interesting because it's really showing off what the attackers are doing, and especially what they are sharing between each other. This one is an example. So for example, there, what do we have here? It's basically an output of a reconnaissance tool with different parameters. But if you have, for example, a match on a specific domains, you have automatically the match, but you have in addition a specific tag saying that is this tool being used for reconnaissance. This one is a bit more complex to describe, but technically it's pretty straightforward. As you know, a lot of script abuse and so on contain, for example, obfuscated string using classical trick like base64, hexadecimal, and so on. So in L, automatically we decode all those strings. So that means they are reprocessed, and we can even do correlation based on that. An example, if you have, a web shell, the web shell contains, again, inside a backdoor within base64, so we decode it automatically, find back the relationship with that, and we can build a relationship between the original files, the correlation, and maybe these patterns of a backdoor has been seen at different places. I think we have some practical example on that aspect. So you see the decoder, for example, this one is like base64 encoded files, and you see that those ones are Windows PE files, so the matching DOS executable files. They have a hash. Automatically, we can see those files into various total. You see the size of the files, how many times has been seen, and you see that some files are regularly seen. Some, for example, remote access tools and so on were discovered like that because it's a way for some attackers to distribute their own tools. The crawler aspect, maybe Aurélien, you want to talk about the crawler?
Yeah, sure. So in L, we are using a crawler to fetch and render a web page. So we are using Splash, which is a scriptable browser. We are using to rendering the patch, so executing everything that is a JavaScript, wait for something like 10 seconds. Then we can fetch the screenshot of the patch and also the content, but also the HA archive, which contains all the requests that have been made to obtain this page. And for that, we are using a Docker container running Splash because Splash is running everything that is JavaScript related, so we want to keep it on a Docker to avoid executing malicious script.
Yeah, indeed, that's quite important because the thing is, for us, it's if you have to instrument browser and so on, you have the security perspective. And so what we do with Splash is really the ability to script that and limit the risk. The risks are still there, but it's basically limiting. And we will talk about the Splash Manager afterwards, about what we can do what you can do with it.
So how does it work in details? When, for example, if you take another address, we have a module calling onion that will extract all the onions that we can find on a paste or an item. We crawl this onion. We'll get back the HTML. We'll form the HTML. We'll extract all the onions that we can find, and we send them back to the crawler. So, for example, we can find a new onion that, for example, we don't know, and we can use it to build a database with all the domains that we found, and so we can discover a lot of domains on the, for example, on Tor. And so, for example, when you want to extract information, for example, for a forum where you know that you can find some interesting information, but this forum requires that you are a member, a registered member, the thing you need to do, you just need to log in on your browser. You extract all the cookies. You give them to Ale, and with that you can crawl it and extract everything from Zim's forum, for example. So here's an example with for example we just logged on a user and so we can access all the posts that for example private for a non-member. And
yeah, so for the forum operators and so on, it looks like a normal browser crawling, and for them it's quite interesting because we basically have no limitations and so on. If you use a crawler without any cookie set like the browser and behaving like the browser, we end up being logged out and we cannot crawl those informations. So it's a quick win for an analyst. We have a very interesting forum with a lot of information. You just like crawl the first two pages, you put into the cookie jar, and then Ale is doing the job for you.
Something to know is by default, when we crawl a domain, we keep all the cookies that's given by the website. So when we follow the link on a website, the operator can tell that we are just a crawler fetching new page and new page. We keep the cookie, so we give it back. So it's a way to avoid the detection. So we are using a manager because we are rendering all the HTML page on a Splash Docker, and those Docker require to have root access. So we create a separate manager that can be run on another server. So this way, this manager can handle all the crawling, rendering, and just send back the information here. So we just send the request and we get the response. This way, you can run a lot of crawler on the same server and at the same time have Ale do all the processing on a different one. So you can be sure that if there, for example, an issue on the crawler, the Splash Manager, it would not affect the L instance. And the Splash Manager is handling the launching, relaunching on all the crawler in case it crash, and so on. But it also handles the web proxy, the Tor proxy, and you can also add your own proxy.
It's a standalone software, so you can even use the Splash Manager alone if you want. So that means you can even use it in standalone software. Just as an example, at Circle, what we do with the Splash Manager from our AL infrastructure is separated. So we have dedicated machines for doing the crawling. So like that capacity-wise and so on, you can split the load of the machines, especially network-wise. If you have to crawl a lot of websites, you have pretty significant bandwidth, and you can have multiple Splash Manager running on a single machine to basically fill your complete bandwidth that you have for these dedicated machines.
So it's just an example of what it looks like in AL, or you can set up the number of crawler you want to launch by, for example, proxy type, and you can also test if everything work, if there's any connection issue, and so that's just basic.
Maybe Aurélien, that means in such kind of situations, we can even use it with multiple VPS and different proxy.
Yeah, you can, yeah.
Okay, so that's great. So that means if you have, for example, a dedicated infrastructure for doing your proxy access and so on, if you want to hide your activities of crawling, you can just use it and having the Splash Manager basically being in front. And between AL and Splash Manager, if I recall correctly, it's just single connections.
It's just a standard connection. You just give the URL of the Splash Manager, the API key, and that's it between AL and Splash Manager.
Okay, great. So some example of thing that we crawled and so on, and we'll go into a live demo before, because I think we will do a small break after the demo. But first, maybe some example of thing that we are crawling. So we use, Aurélien mentioned that we are using Splash, which is basically an instrumented browser. So it means that it's really acting like a browser. And you see that when AL is doing the crawling, we acquire a lot of information. So one is basically the HTML pages and so on, the HIR files, and the screenshots, so like that we can automatically see what a browser sees. There, for example, we are monitoring DDoS booter, DDoS stock tech. No clue if it's still active, this one, but it's a good example. You see on the right side is basically the screenshot there of AL. By the way, and that's this one is quite important, during the demo, it will be activated. Automatically, every web page we crawl is blurred. For various reasons, but if you are crawling Tor and Onion services, you might have a lot of website containing pedophile contents, things like that, or things that you don't really want to see. So automatically we have this be active to avoid the analysis seeing all those pictures. But if you are confident in a website, you just disable it automatically, you have it unblurred. On the left side, you see basically the how it was crawled, so on which port, where it was first seen, last seen, and you see all the tags. And all those tags came from the detections. So from the analysis modules and so on that you have in AL, you see on this one, you have an extraction that is Bitcoin addresses are there, Ethereum addresses, it's Onion, because that means other Onion addresses are on that one. We have a detection for credit cards, and you have a detection for DDoS. You see that you have the original origin of that one. So you see that, and that's again the discussion that we had at the beginning. You need to bootstrap crawling. So if you have a first Onion, we find another one, automatically scroll back and so on. Maybe Aurélien, you want to talk about the crawling strategy in AL on a regular basis or always scroll back on a regular basis and so on?
Yeah. So by default, we extract all the Onion for the item. And what we do is by month, if we haven't crawled, for example, an Onion, we will crawl it. And we will build every iterate on that. And the objective is really to crawl each onion one by month and discover the maximum onion, other onion address that we can find.
And by default, the depth of crawling is only one.
Yeah, by default, on the domain, we go one depth by every link that is on the home page.
So that means you can configure it if you want, and if you want to crawl, you can.
Yeah, yeah, it's just by default, so everything can be changed on.
Okay, cool. On the way, on the screenshot there on the right side, you can see show domain correlation. You see you have cryptocurrencies too. Is showing off that you basically have already two cryptocurrencies addresses there, which can be basically used for correlation and so on. And then when you have the correlations, you can figure out, okay, this website has correlation, and then you can find all the relationship. But we will do a live demo now. So I will switch my browser there. Okay. So first of all, what I will do is I will go to the main pages of Elle. If you want to interrupt me on this, don't hesitate. So this main web pages is showing off a bit kind of status of what Elle is doing. So this one is a production instance. You see that this instance is having some logs. So those logs are basically telling you what has been detected at some point in time. You have different log levels. In this case, we just enable warning and critical, so meaning that the processing activities of Ale logged as warning level. So we have recent entry there, detection of credit card numbers and specific GIST. Yeah. On the left side, you have there the QNAM. So it's basically all the modules running in Ale doing the processing. So for example, there is a module for credentials. And you have, for example, one for credit card, one for CV, and those ones are dedicated ones for finding out specific kind of data. Then here you have a specific graph showing you the number of items processed and from the different sources. You see on this one, we have different sources. We have Jabber, we have URL extracted, we have Twitters, we have different crawlers and so on. So you can basically do automatic search there. And you can have it automatically, so you can have background feeder that are basically feeding the systems, which is the case here, but you can at the same time feed the system with additional additional data. I will show you it later, one with Twitter, where you can basically feed the data into the systems. And you see the overload, I would say the load of the systems, especially that you have some that are taking more time to be processed because they do more activities and more processing on the items. And if you think that it needs more power, you can ask Ale to start more specific things. Then on top, you have on the menu there, you have a specific one for submit items. So you can basically submit a text, raw text. So if you want to quickly analyze something, so for example, you have a PGP key that you just received, you can just paste it there. You can add automatically tags there. So if you want to specific to use specific tags and so on. Regarding tags and Galaxy, so you have all thread actors and so on. Those are all the ones from MISP. So it's fully compatible with MISP. It's exactly the same. So you are basically having the same Galaxy, same. So you have Maitre attack, you have all the tags and so on. So between the two systems, you have the same model of classifications. You can upload files directly. So if you have a PDF file that you want to upload, you can upload it, and automatically you can submit it. Same with text. You can submit a paste that you have. You can just paste it, and that's it. It's not the most efficient way, but if you're an analyst, sometimes it's one way to do it. Then you have on top the different things regarding the tags. So tags is really important because it's basically a way to label all the items and objects that are crossing into Ale. You can use it for finding out specific things that my module has detected. So for example, if I'm taking credentials here, I will find out what the credential modules have discovered just today. So as an example, you see that today on different sources, crawled, extraction of URL, things like that, he found different ones. So for example, I take one, and you see that I have, for example, some Disney Plus account. You see that this one is just today. Hein? So you have like pages of leaks. You see that automatically the system is telling me, okay, this one is coming from a paste that is coming from Twitter with a reference. You see that automatically the system detects it's containing mail addresses, which is correct. You basically have mail addresses. and at the same time, you have credentials. Indeed, you have basically credentials of things. So you see automatically, Ale is able to detect that with the different modules. Then here in this case, for example, it's Disney Plus or Disney access to their pay TV. You can, for example, do an export into MISP automatically, then send an event. So, if, for example, if you have a process or use case for that, you can do it. You can search for correlations. Maybe some of the value there are correlating with others, and you want to see what's going on. Or you can even add this to a specific investigation. So, an investigation is basically a collection of all objects together. And I will show you some examples you can do. So, you see that this one is a very simple thing. This was coming from Twitter, so URL extract, finding out a specific tweet. We can even see the original tweet, and you see that's a tweet containing like, oh, we found 152 new credentials found from that link, and automatically crawling from the feeder and then push into Ale. So that's really important for Ale, is this kind of tagging. So automatically you can tag. You can obviously search for a specific period of times with a specific tag, specific modules, and so on. And it's exactly the same. So credit cards, you can say the one that has been a credit card detected, mail addresses, we are mentioning CV. So we have, for example, one here. I have no clue what it is. So this one is basically a link of an onion containing some specific matching patterns there for different things that are quite, I would say, exotic. Same with onion addresses. So for example, if we discover new onion addresses in another paste, so you see that sometimes onion addresses are obviously on onion websites, but they can be, for example, on a pasties website or an email or whatever. Same with Base64. We can see the same with Bitcoin addresses and so on. You can search image per tag. So that means the screenshot. You can search for the decoded items, so the one that are Base64, for example, or you can even search on a specific per tag and so on. As I said, all the tags and so on are all taxonomies available from MISP, so it's exactly the same. And if you want to add those, you can create automatically those. It make a lot of sense. Then after tags, you have what we call the leak center. So basically, it's term matching. So leak centers have different kind of trackers. So you can basically have the words tracking. You can have the set of words, you can have regex or specific Yara rules. So for example, I'm interested into, PHP obfuscations. And I can see, for example, from the past year, I can see the different things. So I can, for example, go from a 2 year period. And I can see the different activities there on PHP things. So you see that this Yara rules, for the one that are familiar with PHP, it's basically searching for at least two of those terms, ROT 13, Base64 decode, evaluations, strings, or maybe obfuscated eval string. And you see that we are collecting a lot of information from starting 2020, and we see the number of occurrence there, and we can even see, for example, we can go on one, and you see that you have here PHP code, which sounds like a specific PHP shell. And then that works with any terms you create. For example, I don't know if I have one here, which is interesting. So my colleague Jean-Louis has an interesting one for Yara. Where is your? Yes, this one. So there's a rule that he created. I think this is the one that he calls the mammoth rules. This one is a rules containing all the company names in Luxembourg. So it's public. It's publicly. It's not company name. It's bank. Bank names. So it's basically all the banks located in Luxembourg. We have some, obviously. And from that, we can basically create a regular Yara rules. And from that, you have all the occurrences over time. And you can search for the different matching item and object in the database for those different words. So you can really create your own. I mean, if you're familiar with Yara, it's really the same than classical Yara rules for VT. You can even reuse the one from VT it will work out of the box. So leak hunters, if we go back to that, we have an interesting one called retrohunt. And I think this one is important. So technically, it works like that. Ale, when information is coming in, is basically stream things. So we just like match on a specific rule set. The problem is, if we don't have the rule set set when the data is arriving, you might miss it. So that's why we have this retrohunt function. It is exactly the same than varustotal for the one that are familiar with varustotal. You can do retrohunt. So you have a Kyara rules, and then it will search for you on a complete data set, which can be huge, which is the case of our infrastructure. So in this case, we are looking for some certificates. And we keep it running, and then afterwards, the system is telling us, okay, how many hits we have, and we can have a look at those searches. So the leak hunter is really the most commonly used function in Ale, is really searching for keywords, but you have really different way of doing it. Thing that is interesting, if you add a tracker, for example, you see that nowadays we have capabilities of sending out emails, obviously it makes sense, but you can have webhook applications. So that means if you have another application that needs information from Ale, you can just set up a webhook. For example, if I go for Yara rules, you can basically even search for specific rules that are already existing. So for example, you have detections for specific things, like for example, sandbox detect. It's useful when you have, for example, malware and code that is being shared by an attacker on a specific website and so on. Okay. If there's any question, don't hesitate to drop it in the chat and so on. We are there to answer those kind of questions. Then you have the crawler aspect. As I was mentioning, we have different crawler running on its instance. So this one is running the famous Splash Manager. So we see that today it crawled around more than 200 onion addresses, 220, and you see that this one is like basically waiting to crawl any website. You can search by specific domain names. So if you know a specific Tor address, onion address that you want to look at, you can have a look at it. You can search by tag, but you can even navigate, and that's quite interesting, by language too. So for example, if you're interested into only the German crawled websites, so we have a system on Ale to search, for example, all the German websites. So you basically have all the German websites crawled, and you can find out those ones. And obviously, they are blurred. So some you don't have screenshots, for some you have. I don't know if you have something sensitive, but for example, I take this one. Then I can have an additional look on that one. You see that this one is basically a kind of marketplace. You see when this has been crawled, during which period, the different part of the website being crawled. You see that we have some cryptocurrencies mentions. We have a significant number of screenshots. I can maybe increase that. So you see that it's a dark web onion directory. So it's basically a directory of website. So this one is interesting for us because it's a nice way to bootstrap into the onion addresses and so on. Again, for the crawling, you either crawl the onion, so you see the onion addresses that are up and down. So you see that on a regular basis, we recrawl onion addresses. Hidden services on Tor is not so large. I mean, you have around 20,000 onion addresses that are active on a single day. So it's very common. So you have a search engine there where you can basically show active ones, the ones that are up, specific domains and so on. You can have some manual crawler. So if you want to set up a manual crawler, for example, you can crawl a website. For example, I will crawl a circle. I want to crawl it through the web and not through Tor. I don't want to do it manual. I want to keep it and I just want to crawl, for example, 10 pages. I don't use cookie jar, so the cookie jar is basically the thing that was mentioning Aurelien to crawl a website. And then I can say, okay, I want to crawl that website. And if I'm going back on the dashboard, you see that currently the circle website is being crawled by the system. It will take a certain amount of times. And when it's done, basically it will be processed for either or each of the items being processed, it will be into the system, finding, for example, for PGP keys, things like that, and automatically do the analysis for you. Then you can navigate through the domain that you basically collected. So you have this Onion Explorer where you can navigate into the different websites. You can see the different screenshots there. Same with the web domain. So either Tor or Onions are basically the same. You can just like define the one that you want to look at directly. You can specific, for example, I want just to look at the past website being crawled. And then I have the specific screenshot for the different website. So if you want to have a quick view on specific website, it's interesting there. So if I take, for example, this one, see that you have maybe you see you have some additional one for getting through Onion some website and so on. Cookie jar is basically the thing that Aurélien was mentioning. So it's basically the management of the cookie that you can have from a Tor browser perspective. Again, you have this, then the object. So objects are all the specific items in Ale, and especially the one like, for example, PGP dump. I just take those ones today. So many PGP dump that we have seen, so keys, the name associated, and so on. So you see that we have some interesting ones. So I'll take a key, a random one. I have no clue what it is, but you see I have a key that has been seen on two different pages being crawled. I have even the screenshot of the web page. I have no clue what it is. So it's a German website. I can even go a bit further if I want to see the domain associated. So that means I can see there it was on this crawled website and is linked on that specific website. So you basically have all the details about the website itself, the key associated, and so on. And again, you can just add an to an export to MISP and automatically export these currencies. If you have a specific element that is of interest for you, you can double click on it and you end up into another page, which is basically containing the page that has been crawled, all the information, all the correlation, and so on. You see that you can basically browse the thing that you get directly. We do that with a decoded value too. So it's the value that are the base64 hexadecimal and binary values that you have in your system. So that means that has been decoded. And you have some statistics about the specific part. I don't know if I can take one. For example, I just look at today, and you see that I have already today some statistics about, you know, images that are base64 encoded, which makes sense because if you have a lot of websites, if they embedded the image, you have the base64 values. But you have some other interesting ones. But you can, for example, search for specific one, like, for example, DOS executable, things like that when you have malware and so on. So it's quite interesting there. Same with cryptocurrency. So today we see that we have a lot of Bitcoin addresses and so on. I can do a search on just today activities. And it's giving an overview of the different Bitcoin addresses and especially how many times we have seen those. First seen and last seen of the different type. Takes a bit of time because it's quite large. Demo effect. If you do something else, show for something, takes a bit more time. We will let it run when we are navigating maybe another aspect. Just finished now. You see that, for example, I have a Bitcoin address here that has been seen 36 times. I can clean on it, and then I have the relationship of the Bitcoin addresses with different things. Like, for example, it could be an item on a website. You see that on this one, you have the Bitcoin addresses with the different crawl items, and you have even the wonderful website called Parrot Crackers. I have no clue what it is, but you basically see the relationship things, which is quite handy. You can automatically, for example, if you have Bitcoin addresses seen as different places. We have even a nice services called Expand Bitcoins, where you can see the number of transactions and the link with others. So you see that this one is a wallet at zero. So it's not maybe the most interesting wallet. Maybe I can take another one just for the sake of it. I take a random one just for the test. So you see that you have a first seen and last seen. This one is part of more a network of Bitcoin addresses. And you see on this one, we have the number of transactions, the total received, the total sent, but you don't see any addresses in AIL. So the nice thing with that is if you have a transactions containing other Bitcoin addresses, you might see a relationship then with a specific specific website and so on. So it's a way to do correlations from AIL to the Bitcoin aspect. In all of those web pages, you see that you have the investigations. I will come back to that just after. But you see that on the object aspect, you can have investigations. So basically, investigations for the one that are familiar with MISP is like events. It's a collection of things that have semantic meanings together. I'll take one, which is here the AIL workshop one, where you see I just took some example there of things that are commonly seen. So I just took the example of there on adding some objects. So you can create an investigation and add some more objects there. On this one, you have different ones. So I just wanted to show you some interesting example. So I take this one, for example. So you see that this one is from, it's pretty fresh. It's from the 1st of March. Someone was targeting a Russian website and with Nmap. So what you see there, it's automatically the modules of AIL being used. You have on one side, this one contains a CVE numbers because there's some reference of CVE numbers, so meaning that maybe this host is exploitable by those CVE. And then you see an automatic detection that Nmap was used. And indeed, what you have here, it's an output from Nmap. So it's you see that that's quite powerful because afterwards you can search in AIL for only the one matching Nmap tools. And for example, being Russians or things like that. So you can really do such kind of things. So really, I would say the advantage of AIL is really to use those kind of taggings for that. I just took another example, for example, this one. So this one is another website that's been crawled coming from another website that we found back. This one has different things. You see that you have torrent mentions, onion, credentials, scroller mails, and magnet links. So that means there is a lot of things there. So this one sounds like pretty safe, so we'll just have a look at it. And what do I have? Indeed, it's basically a kind of 4chan based forum where you see you have someone that posted, like for example, NordVPN account sharing, and you have some additional reference. Again, other onion addresses, things that you can be used by AIL. So that means you have an address, scrolling it and so on. So it's quite interesting because for an analyst, you don't have to crawl the website. Automatically, AIL is doing the crawling, and automatically what you can discover there is the fact that those websites are already containing some leaks of information. What do I have else from the investigation that are interesting? Yeah, maybe this one is interesting. Very often we have such kind of unstructured information. If you know PHP, this one is PHP code. And you see that this one is like very suspicious, especially this kind of things. It means that you are evaluating a PHP script, which is basically encoded base64, compressed, and compressed second time. So why it's like that is usually some IDS, for example, know some specific beginning of things like string, like PHP, and base64, but if they see that it's compressed two times, they don't see it because it's basically two times round there. So that's quite interesting there. But the thing that is interesting there, you see that you have info leak automatic detections. Are there some questions maybe? No questions? Okay. Then you can see the correlation graph. So this one is interesting there because you can find out specific thing. So this one has no correlations, but I'm looking at another one, maybe this one. So this one is again the same kind of things. PHP script, you have hardcoded password there and so on. Now if you go on the correlation graph, you see that L was able to figure out that, okay, this base64 that is part of this pastebin is at various places. And if you select a random one, again, it's another shell. So what happens here? It's really straightforward. You see that those files usually contain a lot of base64 values. For example, even hard-coded passwords. So this one is an hexadecimal values that we pivot on. And if you have a hard-coded password that is the same, you have all the same hard-coded password seen in the correlation maps. So which is quite interesting there. I don't know if I have another example there. CV, no. Oh, yes, this one is interesting too. So this one is one of today. And you see that we have no tags on this one. This one is a match that we have on the Yara rules about database link. And you see that you have a set of database on the internet that are wide open, MySQL one, MariaDB one, with the credential. And you see that it's pretty active there because it's also a Belarusian government database. We just found it from Twitter. So this one has been posted on Twitter, then on a specific link, and that automatically AL was basically getting the correlations. We can have a look at these users, but we see that we have only one entry. So we have Sparrow, which is this user. We most probably crawl that one on Twitter from the leak keyword and so on. So you see this functionality in AL is quite interesting. It's really that you have investigations. You can create all your investigations. And afterwards, when you have this investigation, you can obviously export it as a MISPVAT. So everything can be shared back into another instance for additional distributions, collaboration, and so on. And by the way, AL is able to export in MISP, but import into MISP too. So you can import back data that you get from the different systems. Maybe I forget something. No, everything is fine. Okay. So it was quick introduction of the user interface. So what I would propose now, it's basically a break for everyone. Maybe we should start back at 3, if it's fine, 3 all time. If there's any question in the meantime and so on, don't hesitate to use the chat to share information and so on. And if you are already user of AL and so on, and you have questions and so on, don't hesitate during the session. So we will start again at 3 p.m. Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back. So what I will do is I will show to you some additional aspect of L, and then we go more into the presentation aspect on MISP, and then more on the development or to extend L and so on. I wanted to just show you some interesting example that I found today. So you see in this case we have two tags, one where there's an automatic detection that they are males, and one which there's a match on Europa that I use. And this one is interesting because it's basically a leak. It's a database dump. So it's basically a database dump coming from a JSON success error. So it sounds like to be an injection somewhere. But this one is a fresh one. So you see that sometimes when you basically have just minimal detections scheme, like just a specific keyword, things like that, you can really easily find out some interesting leak and so on. So again, the act of creating those kind of filters and so on and leak monitors might be a bit of work at the beginning, but when you start to have a very nice set of matching keywords and so on, it's really giving a lot of interesting results there. As you can see for this this specific case. So again, if you're using L, the investigation aspect, which has been recently introduced, is really straightforward and easy to use, and is really an easy way to, you know, stack different things together to be able to do further analysis and so on. I don't know if there are other interesting ones then I need to dig into, but you see that's basically how it works. It's really straightforward. So it's a quick introduction of what AL is capable of. Obviously, you have plenty of other things like synchronization, things like that, but I think my colleagues will go more into the synchronization aspect, how it works and so on. And all the configuration that you have. So you basically have user management, things like that, which are, I would say, very normal for such kind of tools. You can have different kind of users and so on. You can see the status of the server and so on. So a lot of things can be done through the user interface, but obviously a lot of those things can be done from the command line. And especially all those modules that you have running there in AL are autonomous and independent. You can even access those through GNU screen sessions. So that means they are independent Unix sessions. So you can connect to those and even debugs the output of the specific module that you see here. So for developing and debugging, it's really really convenient there. Okay. Okay. Sorry. So going back to the live demo then, just this one is just like in case that we had no demo functional, so that's why we have some screenshot. Okay, MISP integration. This one is quite important because for us as Circle, we are using obviously a lot of MISP. So the integration is like quite, I would say, advanced on our side. We are using on a day-to-day basis. So that means a lot of components from MISP are integrated into ALS and much more will be integrated. I'm thinking, for example, of Cerebrate software component where we have, for example, the creation of sharing groups. This could be directly integrated into AL, so that's, we have some plan there, so like that people can efficiently get the sharing groups immediately in AL. In addition to that, it's already available, as I mentioned, the MISP taxonomies are accessible and functional in AL. So that means we basically have the same classification and tagging. Why we do so, it makes a lot of sense for us, because the thing is, if the classifications is not globally common among different tools and so on, it starts to be a bit, I would say, a mess. So for us, it makes a lot of sense. So that means we basically share the same labels and tags among the different instances. So for example, we have things like estimative language, things like that are already available in the MISP taxonomies, and you can reuse those. And again, you can do exactly the same that you do in MISP. You can basically extend it, create your own JSON format, and you can even cherry pick one or extend an existing one. Just for the sake of it, What are the most interesting taxonomies that are useful in L? You have a thing in the overall library taxonomies of MISP, around 250 taxonomies nowadays. But I mean, those ones are one that are actively used. InfoLeak, this one is dedicated for L, is basically all the classification about data leaks. So for example, the modules in ELS are using the InfoLeak taxonomy. So you have seen that in the example that I showed to you from the, can go back to the investigations. You see on this one, I'm using the InfoLeak, for example, for this one where you have InfoLeak automatic detections credentials. How it works is quite interesting. So these taxonomies helps to simplify it, I would say, the triage afterwards. So as an example, if I'm going to the taxonomy there on InfoLeak, that's the overall documentations. You have two main predicates. You have one which is called automatic detections, and this one called analyst detections. How does it work? So on your L instance, it means when you have automatic detections, it's obviously coming from any of the modules. So it's an automatic detections. Nevertheless, sometimes an analyst might not agree with what the automatic detection is, and then they can change or add the manual detection then, saying that, okay, my proper classification in this one. So the nice thing with that is you can basically filter out if you want to have only data from automatic analysis or manual detections, or you can even use both into the system. So it's interesting to have. So it's basically analyst and manual detections for all the values. And you see that it's basically matching the different modules that we have in L. Other one, like estimative language, those one are, I would say, classical for the analyst. It's describing the quality and credibility of the underlying sources, data methodologies. So it's basically a label that is giving you some level of credibility that you can have with data, which is basically linked to the admirality scale, which is a NATO scale, depending of which background you are and what kind of taxonomies that are used by your team, you might use admirality scale or estimative language. Another thing, one that is very interesting, and this one is going back to our initial discussion about the GDPR, is what we call the FPF1, which is a Future of Privacy Forum. It's basically evaluate the degree of identity that you are sharing. So is the data pseudonymous, de-identified, or is really anonymous data? As you have seen, a lot of data is not anonymous at all. It's basically email addresses, things like that. So like that, you can properly label it and then decide what you do with it and how you need to, for example, further process it for example, removing sensitive information, partially de-anonymize it and stuff like that. Other things that are interesting, you have one which is basically the Tor one, which is describing Tor network infrastructure, very useful for hidden services and so on. Another one is the dark web one. We are actively using that one because this one is a nice one for classifying forums and things like that. We have seen that those forums are containing a lot of information. So for example, you might have topics like this one is selling drugs. This one is more cash in, cash out. This one is more about hacking. So it's more about credential at our share and stuff like that. So it's really useful for that. Another one, Coping Scale, which is one that is used for describing image of child sex abuse, is not really our use case, but for some law enforcement and police, it's really actively used. This one is available too, so you can even use it in AIL to classify the severity of the images that you have on the platforms. Obviously, what I was mentioning, AIL project is automatically and can share information toward MISP. So if I'm going back to my instance here, I can go into tags. I have this what we call auto push services, so which is basically telling AIL when, for example, you encounter, I don't know, base64 values or InfoLeak for CV and so on, is automatically push on a MISP instance. You can, for example, say that you send it to an event creations. Same is the same here for the one using the Hive. You can auto export data and so on. One of the ideas is basically to have a pluggable module there for extending it to some other stream protocol for covering the pipelines of some other certs that might have in their infrastructures. Again, L objects are basically MISP core format again. So L is really using the MISP format behind the scene. So it's really the same standard that we provide at the EIETF for MISP. The nice thing with that is we can export, obviously, in one way. So for example, we have an interesting things with cryptocurrencies, with all the connections, relationship, and so on. We can push it back into MISP. But we can re-import it back. So imagine the case where you basically have two L instances connecting to another MISP, for example, from the CCIRT network. You might want to be able to re-import it back into your L instance for further correlations, because you might have more data and things like that. You can do it. Even if you don't have synchronization between two L instances, MISP can use as a transport mechanism between those kind of things. So it's quite useful. Obviously, you can export things like the complete screenshot, information about the website that you've been crawled, and things like that directly into MISP. When you export into MISP, you select the set of objects that you want. What are the level of distance that you want? So you have seen that we have graph. So how far you want to go into the basically connection between the different graph things. And then you export it with the different things that MISP knows about distributions, thread level, and so on. And it's where basically Cerebrate will play a role here. In addition to basically select the sharing groups and so on, we might use the directory of Cerebrate to automatically populate the potential sharing groups that you have access to. So it could be nifty when you have like a lot of sharing groups and when you have to share a lot of information and so on. As I was mentioning, this can be automatic based on the submission of tags. So that means if a specific tag is set, you set it automatically. Same, for example, you have a tracker. The tracker is detecting something. Based on the detections, you set a tag, and then the tag will automatically submit to MISP. That's really the model behind the scene. Quickly talking about the API, maybe Aurélien, you want to talk about the API?
Yeah, sure. So currently, we are covering something like 60% of the whole backend, and we are going to be sure to cover everything. We are also currently using a Python library which is called PileAle to feed Ale with items. That's, for example, the library that you are using in a lot of your feeder. So for example, I just have a small example here. That's what we are using to feed, for example, item to Ale. So it's pretty fair forward. It's almost the same thing as MISP. You need the API key and just set the data to the endpoint, and that's it. You have some documentation, but it's very far from being complete. So we are going to complete it as we can.
Yeah, and the feeder, for example, are actively using that to post items there on the different API and so on.
You are going to extend it, for example, to allow also to crawl the domain directly via the Python library, for example. So maybe just a quick word about how setting up the framework. So it's pretty straightforward. You just need to clone the repository and just load the install script that will handle the UI and backend installation, all the dependencies, and also the installation of Redis and Cave Rock that we are going to replace in the future with.
Maybe regarding specification of machines. How much RAM you need and so on. So just for your information, the machine that we were doing the demonstrations of our machine with like a lot of RAMs and so on, obviously it depends on what you are crawling on a daily basis, what kind of data you will process. So for example, for some exercise and so on, we were using virtual machines for L, but it's not really very appropriate because L, from a processing standpoint, need at least between 8 and 16 gigabytes of memory. So if you don't have that, it will be tough to run AIL, especially if you are processing, for example, all hidden services from Tor. So usually we recommend to have small dedicated machines. So the thing that is quite important too is basically to have SSD. A lot of the data are basically stored into RocksDB backends, which are basically on the disk. So if you want to have fast lookup, you need to have SSD. So that's something that we recommend. So if you have to set up L infrastructures, we usually recommend at least two bare metal machines, one for the crawling and one for all the L framework directly, with at least, I would say, 32 gigabytes of memory. It works in virtual machines, but don't forget that if you share disk with others and so on, it's pretty intensive disk-wise. And for network access, it's intensive on the network network level too. So keep in mind. So we are, for example, running our complete L framework infrastructure on two dedicated machines. Those have 32 core CPUs, and we have around, I think, 128 gigabytes of memory for running that. And we can crawl completely Tor and so on, and save screenshots and so on. And you have multiple terabytes of data for storing the database and different screenshots there. So it's manageable, but keep in mind, depending on what you plan to crawl. So if you feed, for example, L frameworks with multiple leak of multiple terabytes, obviously you might need some storage mechanism there. We will talk about maybe some new features to control the volume of data being stored. So we have currently a redesign plan for the lifetime of the data in the system. So like that, we can automatically expire data from the system to avoid, for example, that we have too many screenshots and stuff like that, depending on your policy of retention. Okay, so I show to you how L is working, but obviously one of the main role when you are operating L is basically feeding the systems. And better is the feeding, better are the results at the end, because it means that you basically have good data sources and so on. So that's quite important. So we have, I would say, more than one way to do it. And feeding L, it's, I think, difficult, but I think it's maybe the most important things to do. And there are different ways of doing it. So I will mention multiple ones today. We will have a practical example of a data set that has been leaked the past days that Jean-Louis will show you. So it's basically to see how you can collect the information. So for example, one of the original one, and this one is an example, but it's what we call PySmon. It's a tool that has been developed by multiple people, but it's basically a feeder that is basically collecting on all those pasties website, Pastebin, GitHub, and many others. So you can basically set a PySmon, connect a stream to L, and then automatically send to L. So for example, we use that PySmon for collecting on some of the services. It's another component, you can use it and so on. On the other hand, you can use JSON feeders. I will go into detail about that one. For example, all the Twitter, the data that you have seen, feeder from JSON raw format, from Discord, Telegram, and so on, are coming through that way. You have other options using the API. So Aurélien was mentioning the API where you can basically post data. We have even dedicated scripts. So if you want to run it on Unix-like on your operating servers, you can use the import dir script. And you can, as I showed to you, you can even use a UI to feed the system. So that's basically four different ways of doing it. So UI, I show it to you. It's basically very simple. You submit the paste, automatically be processed. Don't forget to set tags. You can even like that see the overall process and the detection mechanism from the UI. If you use from the API, you basically just like set a JSON, import the data with tags that you want, the text and text to import. So it's super straightforward. Nowadays, people are basically feeding L with all the different feeders. So publicly, we manage under the L project more than 12 feeders that are available. And we know a lot of people doing their own private feeders because sometimes you don't want to disclose or share what kind of sources you have. It's usually a way to get the external sources. So why set up like that? There are multiple reasons for that, but one of the main reasons is a lot of CCRT want to run their feeder sometimes far away from their rail framework, either for security reason, sometimes even for privacy reason, or because they want to do collections very close to the sources. So we have plenty of feeders that are pure Python script. You basically just need request to do the submit just JSON, and that's basically it. The feeders themselves doesn't really need to be linked to AL framework. So we will show you later on the modules or to write the modules where there's really an internal logic for AL. In the case of the feeder, they have their own internal logic. So you can do basically whatever you like. If you want to run whatever script, bash script, Rust, Lua, whatever, you can run your internal logic. As long as you basically push the JSON format with the metadata, you can feed into the systems. And AL is pretty lax on that. So we have some predefined metadata in the JSON. So you can have a look at GitHub repository of the Twitter feeder. I will go to that one just after to show you how it works. It's pretty straightforward. I mean, there's no very complex logic there. As long as you know what you are doing with the data, you just like mangle it into a JSON and push it to AL. And that's basically it. So what kind of feeder are available? So one of the feeders that we developed is one that has been developed for Twitter. And this one, we developed it internally for our use case. The most important thing for us was to be able to basically index stuff from Twitter without using the API, which basically a lot of services doesn't like, including Twitter. We are relying on another tool called Twint. We even maintain our own version because the maintainer of Twint disappear, but we are still maintaining it for ourselves. So it's basically a way to search Twitter without touching the API. So it's pretty handy. And then this Twitter feeder is even crawling the URLs and so on and pushing the result into AL. So just for the sake of it, I'll show you quickly all those kind of AL feeder repository are done. So you basically have a README with the explanation of how you can use it. You have the way to use it there. The different output that is going to AL. So usually what you have is basically one single feeder. So you see that this feeder is basically 200 lines. It's, I would say, a complex one because you can even do simpler one. And you have basically a configuration file, which is basically matching your UID of the things, where to push the AL, your API key, and a specific cache to not resubmit data on a regular basis, and you can run the tool. So what I will show you to you is basically an example of how it works. So for example, I want to feed for example link from pastebin.com that has been seen on Twitter. So the feeder, what it will do, the feeder will basically search for pastebin link on Twitter and crawl them and submit it automatically them on AL. And then if you go back to AL, in this case, you can even see the output coming from the from Twitter there. It takes some time, so you see that it's popping up. So you see you have already one that I've found. URL extracts with 1,000 email addresses. This one is just popping up from URL extract, which is basically the tool I'm currently using for pushing the data. And you see that those one which is already processed are cached. So like that, we don't resubmit. So that means if I'm doing a search again on a Twitter for pastebin.com, obviously I might have one tweet, but that's it. And no more tweet to resubmit into the system. So you see it's pretty straightforward. There's no black magic. And you can do that with any keyword search that you want. So for example, if I'm interested into leaks, for example, then it will search into Twitter for all keywords and hashtags matching leaks and submit it into AL automatically. So that's one of the feeders. So the AL feeder is really straightforward. So if you want to start from scratch and write your own feeders, have a look at the Twitter feeder. It's a good example of what you can do. We can do with a feeder. So you see that we have more things coming from Twitter from that feed. Another one, and this one is pretty interesting and new. It's a feeder coming from the certificate transparency. So maybe some of you are already familiar with that. So every certificate authority has to publish all the register certificate and signed certificate into a global Merkle tree that is basically available on different places. And there are services like the CertStream, which is basically a server giving you all those certificate transparency logs. It's pretty large, so it's multiple megabits per second, but you basically get all the new domain registers. So it's super interesting for Elle for various reasons. You can get new domain names, new host names, but sometimes you get even SSL certificate containing onion addresses. So it's a one way to feed the system with new onion addresses that you don't know about that might pop up into the feeders. Same with that, you can extract automatically link. So one of our plans on this one is to add the typo squatting. So for example, if you have a domain name that's doing typo squatting on a specific domain names, you can automatically extract it from the feeders and then push it into L for doing the crawling. So like that, you can have the full chain of detections. Initially, when the attacker is and the adversary is creating a domain and asking for a certificate is basically end up into L. So it's like a quick way to get the full chain of information there. So the certificate transparency aspect is new. We are working on it, so expect in the next weeks even additional things that we are doing there. But it's another way of really feeding L with really interesting information. Another one, and this one is becoming a critical one for some organizations. So we have two feeders for GitHub. So as you know, GitHub is used by many organizations. And very often you have organizations that are basically leaking things like credentials, configurations of sensitive stuff, link. We recently see, for example, a repository where people were pushing VPN access to make their continuous integrations, but it was not supposed to be there. So an attacker could use it and so on. So our model is the following. We have two feeders, one for something called GitHub Archive. So it's not really operated by GitHub, but it's a researcher which is crawling all the commit messages from GitHub to basically have a full archive. So that means you can retroactively feed L with specific data set. So then you can do the filter. So for this repository, it's quite interesting. So we can do some filtering. So for example, we can have a list of username, we can have a list of organizations, or even specific words to search, and then we push it back into L. So like that, we can even do the pre-filtering really at the collection of the source. Because the problem is the data set is usually pretty large. You might have a lot of false positives, but sometimes you really want to focus on a specific time. So for example, you can extract, you want, for example, to have a specific data set, and you want to see that I want to search for all those password removed commit messages, which makes sense. For example, if you are working, I don't know, for the European Commission, and you have users or contractors using GitHub repositories and they're removing passwords from their Git commit, you might want to have a look at those one automatically because they might leak some interesting information. So that's one of those feeders. And we do the same for GitHub repository. So we can feed full-blown GitHub repository inside L. This one is a bit more intensive because it's even collecting additional information through the GitHub API key. So depending of the user and so on. So it's really a simple way to do Git repository monitoring through else. And those feeders are interesting to look at because it's a way to feed the system. This one is an interesting one, is an external contributions from a partner. So they very often they receive like a dump of leaks, but they have no time or resources to really handle this one automatically. So they write what they call the leak feeder. So it's an L feeder leak, which is basically getting large leak. So very often you have torrent of like gigabytes or even terabytes of leak. If you want to submit into L, it can be a bit cumbersome because you need to split the data, decompress, parse it, encode it, and then pass it back into L. This feeder is basically doing everything for you. So we can have quickly a look on this one. So this one is super easy to use. You basically install the requirements, you have a leak folder where you put the folders, and automatically the tool is doing the chunking, the data and so on, and putting into L framework just for you. So it's quite interesting and efficient for automatic processing of large league of information. Another one that is interesting too is ActivityPub. So this one, not maybe everyone is familiar with that, but it's a kind of series of social networks on the internet that are using kind of distributed social networks. Maybe you know Mastodon, which is a well-known alternative to Twitter, which is using ActivityPub. You have plenty of different services using ActivityPub. This one is a generic tools to use ActivityPub. Again, it's a specific modules because this one you need to have account on the instances, but then you can feed everything there back into your L instance directly. Another one, this one is the feeder Telegram, so you can have you can feed into Telegram from Telegrams into L's chat rooms, communication, and so on. Be careful on that one. You really need a Telegram account and an API ID and hash for actively using it. So it's not like the Twitter feeders where you basically don't need to use an API key. So if you don't mind to share phone numbers with Telegram and crawling, that's fine. But be careful, this one needs authentication and so on. We have plenty of other feeders. There's one for Discord. So this one is a way to feed Discord channels. So if you know the Discord instance that you want to monitor, you can basically just like feed it into L automatically. There are more generic ones. One is for Atom or RSS readers. So that means you have RSS feeds. You point them to the feeders. It will extract the data and send it back into L automatically. There's a generic one, which is sometimes you basically have JSON files that are like very complex, but you really want to feed everything in one single shot. So this one is the script that is basically doing everything for you, aggregating and flattening everything to put it back into Rails. Very handy when you get a lot of JSON files. Then Jean-Louis will show you how to feed it with some custom JSON and especially one specific one.
Share screen. Can see the screen. Oops. Yes. So you can hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So So at the end of February, there was this this leak about the Conti ransomware gang, and so there were several things. But the first thing that hits the internet was some Jabber leaks. So Jabber is a mean to communicate via chat, and the look of the leaks was some JSON files. So you had a timestamp, a from field, a to field, and a body. So for us, that was very interesting to look into that because there was a lot of HTTP links, so leading to onion addresses and hidden services. And also you had the beacon addresses and stuff like this. And the things that as it's a lot of messages, you want to be able to identify warehouse, all the stuff. And you want also to get some context. So for instance, when you have a Bitcoin address, you want to see who uses it and in which conversation and stuff. So that's why I used the custom feeder for Ale, so I could actually keep the timestamp. So I know actually when the message was emitted and who is talking to whom. So the first thing that I had to do was translate the files. So I did this with DeepL, but it's out of context here. And yes, so it was very good candidate for Ale because we wanted to extract PGP keys, onion services, and things like this. So Ale was lacking the support for Jabber IDs as usernames, so we added this just for this leak and created the feeder to import the JSON data into Ale. So it's very, very simple. So it's just using the PyAle library. And then it's reading information from STDIN, so standard input. load the JSONs, then search for the body. So the body is actually the content of the message, and put this in temvar. That would be the data of this JSON file we'll send to ALE. And then we map metadata to ALE metadata. So as I created this Jabber username thing in ALE, I could actually map the to Jabber to metadata in ALE, from to Jabber from in ALE, and so on. And then I just generate some UID to keep track of this. And then we push each message like this in ALE, and ALE will be able to make sense of it. So I can show you what it looks like. So here, so you can see the screen still. Yeah. So here you can see that it's like an empty instance that I used just for this, because you have a lot of messages and I didn't want to pollute another instance with all of this data. So I actually have this Jabber source. And if I go into objects, username, now here we see we have a Jabber type. And I can go in the past, because those leaks started in 2020. So I can start 2020 in March until now, show username, I search, and I will have a graph of all the messages we have. So you can see that we have a lot of data and a lot of people talking, and we can actually order this by the number of items. For instance, the EV talker are Target, Bentley, Stern, Defender, all those guys. So if you look into those people, so I clicked on those guys before because you have a lot of so for instance, this one here is, okay, a bit too much. So I have some that are already deployed. Let me check. So for instance, this one is Stern. So Stern is one of the boss, basically. And you can see that you have a lot of Bitcoin addresses. So this one is talking money, basically. And you have other guys. So for instance, let me check. So this one is Stern. Something else, Stern again. This one is Bentley. Bentley is a bit different. So here, okay, maybe I don't have enough nodes, but this guy talk a bit less money. And then you have also, but still maybe talker of money. And then you have Defender. Defender is more like, it looks like he's more of a, I don't know, dispatcher or something like this. He talk to a lot of people and don't talk much about money. So something that we wanted to see is, do we have an intersection between those leaks and what we have already in ALE? The thing is that you don't want to put everything in your big instance. So what we do is that, so here you can see this command line here. So I just cat every file I have in this conti folder, use GQ just to have everything on one line, and feed this into ALE with the feeder.py. But I can actually do some grepping on this just to select what interests me. So for instance, I can do some grep on PGP just to get all the PGP keys, and then we can actually keep this, so already see if there are some intersection, but also keep it for later. So maybe it will pop up somewhere in a leak somewhere else or something like this, but then we'll keep it. Same for Onion Hidden Services, we want to scroll this. So we'll grab for this and push this into the thing. Telegram addresses, same thing. Bitcoin addresses, things like this. So then we just keep the thing that we want. So if I just cut my file, it looks like this. You have a lot of lines. Then I can just grab. I want, I don't know, someone talking about Monero. So it will grab the whole thing. And you see that you have in those messages, one guy here saying, I have a Monero instead. So you're like, oh, you have a Monero, but ALE understand Monero.
Maybe you want to zoom in.
Ah, sorry. Can I do that? Because I'm in a screen, so I'm not sure. Okay, but the idea is that I can do just, let me check if I can zoom in. I'm not sure about that. Nope. No. Preferences. Where is it? Ah, here.
Shift control plus.
It's better, no?
Yes, wonderful.
Okay, great,
thanks.
Okay, great. So yeah, I can do grep Skippy. That was the guy who wanted to add Monero, and all that is Skippy related, I can decide to push it inside else. So in this case, I just do Python, and then use my feeder.py. And it will send everything Skippy to Ale. Okay, let's stop this because maybe I don't want to have everything Skippy into Ale. Okay, so that's the idea. And now if I go into the bigger instances we have, we can actually go and try to see if there are some intersections. So for instance, this one is on the big instance. And the thing is that so far we didn't really find any intersection with everything. The big win would be to find a Bitcoin address that go in a big pool, but not yet. Something like this. But it needs but more.
You saw something on the mixer.
Maybe I saw something, but I can't find it back. So for now, it's okay. But I will find it back one day. And okay, that's about it for this one, I think. Yes. Stop.
Okay, so was a quick introduction of how you can feed custom JSON. So this one is a fresh one that we recently received. So that's the idea. So you can basically feed anything like, you know, any JSON file that you can see there. So thing is, as you can see, it's pretty straightforward. Just something to keep in mind if you start to use Ale and so on. Don't hesitate to basically split data and sharing the data. So for example, the leak feeder for a very large data set is interesting because this one is coming from a partners that having the problems of submitting very, very large files. So if you want to basically inject data, keep reasonable size for all the chunks. So usually what you assume is basically less than 3 megabytes. It's usually a reasonable size. Jean-Louis showed to you Jabber logs and so on, and those one are containing, for example, each time a JSON files. And those one are pretty small to split, and it's pretty straightforward to split because it makes a lot of sense. But sometimes you have like huge leak and so on, so you have to do the split and so on. So that's why you have this kind of leak splitter as a feeder to keep this make sense. Because the thing is, if you have very large files, that means each module has to take a lot of time for processing. If you want to benefit from multi-processing and so on, it's usually better to have very small files. You can even stream it directly. So you have, if you look at the import dir, we are using 0MQ. So that means the import dir itself can be even run on another machines and on a different device, and you can run it on your own there. So now that you have installed the framework, so the compilations of the framework, as mentioned by Aurélien, is pretty straightforward. And then you have a kind of what you call launcher, and the launcher is basically doing everything for you for the launch and so on, and including starting the backend system and the web interface that you have access to. So what do you need for running an instance is basically having a development tool set on a recent Ubuntu versions, and then you can run your Ales directly.
The launcher is also handling the update of Ale. So for example, when a new tag is added, it will also git pull the repository, apply the update, for example, update something in the DB that we that we change, and it will handle everything on the backend. And it's launch when you use minus L option, but you can launch it manually with on the other slide and with the minus U option.
Which is basically doing the update for you. That's correct.
Yeah, yes, it is everything for the update for you. So you don't need to
take care of it. For the curious that know about new screen, so if you launch, it's basically handling a lot of screens. So if you do screen minus L with the same user, you'll see a lot of screens that are running. And those ones are basically the infrastructure with all the modules and so on. So for debugging, for example, or basically looking at what's going on in two logs on a specific modules, you can just connect to these screen sessions and have a look at what's going on there. Okay, technically, what is a backend? Because the thing is, it's a quite a challenging models to deal with a lot of data, which are different. So right now, the data and the backend is running on Python 3, so Python 3 latest versions. We have two kinds of database. So we have an in-memory database, which is using Redis. And we have another database, which is using currently RareDB, but we are migrating to KVROX, which is basically a Redis compatible database with a RocksDB backend. So it's pretty fast. And that's why it's required usually to have SSD. You can run it on a normal disk, but it will be much, much slower. The front infrastructure is Flask there. In the backend and the data messaging is basically using 0MQ, Redis list and Redis publisher subscriber. And maybe we'll explain just after why it's like that. So if you look at the streaming model of L, and I will might be a bit zoom in because it's the interesting aspect of L. It's basically based on different modules. Maybe you want to talk about the different modules, Aurélien?
Yeah, sure. So here we have all the modules that detect everything and you just focus on the important one. So all the objects and the item will first be handled by the mixer. We'll check if maybe the item was already processed and just maybe drop it. And it will fetch all the items for all the different jobs, for the JSON feeder, from the ZMQ, and maybe the interface. And it will send it to global. Global will save the data on the disk, tag the item if, for example, with the JSON feeder on the UI, a tag was needed and was already applied. Once the data is saved on the disk, it will be sent to a MIDI module, for example, Telegram, will check, for example, then a Telegram link. But another important one is a KTAG module that we check, for example, if the word credit card, for example, or one of the 100 most common password is in the item. And if one, for example, for the password, one of the 100, the first 100 password is in the item, we will send it to the credential module to extract the credential. And for a lost module, once we found something interesting, we'll first send it to the duplicate module, for example, for the credential to check if we found something that was already posted, for example, a long time ago, or if, for example, it's really some really new password. And we'll also send it to the tag module. We'll tag the item and also send it to the sync module that, for example, we send it to the another L instance. We'll talk about it a bit later, but also to the miss module that just quickly send to a MISP event if, for example, we match a set of item. And for example, everything with the mixer module and the credential module.
Yeah, just maybe something important there. All those modules can be reconfigured. So you can change the flow if needed, depending of the use case of the instance.
And when you create the new module, you can plug it anywhere if you know what you have for message. For entry message. Yeah, so here it's just a quick overview of how it works internally. So a module just push the output on a ready set, and other module will just plugging on the output and just spop pop from the set to get the message. So all the module will get the same message.
Maybe the why it's like that is really important for multiprocessing.
So for example, for multiprocessing, you can launch the same module multiple times. So for example, if you have a module that require a lot of processing, you can launch it multiple times to handle a large amount of item and speed up the processing.
And this explains to have small items to be processed on a very large one.
Yeah. So will quickly show you how to create a new module. So the first thing to know is where you want to put it in the module flow. So is it something that you want to check? For example, is the word is present? You maybe want to plug in after KTAG, the KTAG module, or if you just want to directly work on the content, mais you just need to plug in right after the global module. So the module will save it on disk. And if you want to add the tag or check if there is a duplicate, you can push the output to the tag and duplicate module. So writing a new module is pretty straightforward. We have an abstract class that is called actras module. You just need to extend that class. So for example, with a new module, you just init this class. For example, if you want to add an internal variable or things like that, and you just need to add this function, this compute function, which just handles the message and do something with it. The abstract class will handle the depopping of the module, so extract the message from the queue and send it back. You just need to do some things with the message, and it will handle everything else. And you just need to create the class and run it, and we don't handle everything.
Maybe Sami want to take the floor then.
Okay, so I will just chime in for that specific slide. So AIL is an open source project that we maintain. We've had already quite a lot of contribution from others, people like partners or even just people wanting to try it out and finding some bugs and wanting to fix it. But by any means, if by any chance you fix something, you create new feeder, you create new modules, please share it with us, because that's how the project can grow. that's also a nice way for you to get feedback, free feedback actually. So ways for you to improve the module, increase the performance and so on. So really, if you do create some content for this project, please be kind enough and share it back with us.
Yeah, we had already a lot of contributions. So I was mentioning different feeders. So I think half of the feeders are from us, but there's some feeders that are coming from third parties and other things. So for example, a lot of other people contributed. I remember SensorOut contributing the reconnaissance tools, the SQL injections tools, email alerting is coming from a German companies. There are people that are maintaining some Ansible, Docker script and so on. So really, I mean, for us, it's important to have contribution there. If you plan to use AIL and you don't exactly know to use it and so on, just like reach us to us. We can just even discuss how it works and how you can use it on a daily basis. And we are more than eager to get even feedback on how you can improve it on the long term there. So all the contribution work is basically you can really fork the code. Play with it and make some patches and so on and add the additional analysis modules. Aurélien showed to you how to create these modules. So basically with the abstract class, which is a rework from a partner basically that wanted to have something simpler, which is I think a good way of doing it. So it's easy for us to make a pull request, for you to make a pull request, and then we can review it and integrate it into AIL easily. So that's basically it for this. So the thing is and really the important thing for us is AIL is there to facilitate and especially to reduce the time of detections, because it's really that is important. I mean, when we see ransomware groups planning to release data in 48 hours. If you have it like 1 hour after or like 10 minutes before, it's basically sometimes a bit late. If you basically got it immediately when the ransomware gang is basically publishing it, is like a gain of time for you and for the victims to basically react and do maybe something more appropriate. So really the thing of AIL is to fasten and improve the way of notification and so on. And that's really what we want to do on the long term with AIL. Just for thing is, how do you do development in AIL and for projects? We really like to have gradual changes. So to add some functionalities, we right now have a roadmap plan for 2 years, I think, on development and additional functionalities. But some I would say golden rules are applying for us, and especially the aspect of time memory trade-off. Let me explain that. You can come with a very nice algorithm doing machine learning and so on for doing classifications. But if you cannot process a data leak in less than 1 hour, for example, that you receive, and you need like days to be able to process it, you might have a problem of times. And on the other end, if you have like very small, I don't know, Twitter feeds, and then you end up with like using like hundreds of megabytes of memory for a single tweet, you might have a challenge for processing. So we always check that. So for contributions, we really like that people are finding like, I would say, shortest path or quickest path, which is basically like understanding the trade-off regarding time and memory, which is super important for us, or time and space, that is quite important. Again, if you integrate new modules, we try to have those modules that are comparable time memory wise to the other modules, so to not impact others. If it's a case, but still interesting modules, then this module is becoming optional, and then people decide if they want to go in that trade-off. Right now, we have a pretty large project, but the thing that is quite challenging is the semantic aspect. As you have seen in the different demo, it's a lot of content from different sources. It might be in different languages, not only natural languages, but what we call programming or synthetic languages. So it's basically a lot of challenges for doing automatic classification and so on. But you have an ongoing project for improving that. It's part of a self-funded project called GTAN, where we are working with different partners to be able to improve the semantic analysis of AIL item and so on. So what are on the radar for this year, and those should be implemented by this year. It's obviously, we will add new JSON feeders. So that's, I would say, an ongoing process. So if you see a new social network, new data sources and so on, we will add those. One that is critical is the data retention and lifetime management of objects to be able to clean up things when you have to process a lot of data. So it's basically a kind of life cycle management like we do for MISP for indicators and so on, but there it will be for item. Thing that we wanted to do is to have a complete integration of MISP module expansion. So the thing that we have in MISP module is to be able to expand some data, and we want to benefit from those modules in AIL. Thing that is really short term is we already developed a dedicated typo squatting library for the certificate transparency, but this extension will be available in the tracker. So like that, we can find typo squatting informations as a tracker. So for example, if you have, I don't know, specific domain names and you want to have all the potential typo squatting domains, it will be generated for you and then created as a tracker into AIL. As I was mentioning, the semantic analysis aspect, which is, this one is a large work and significant work to be done. It's based on what we call auto-classification. So it's basically labeling of information based on set of terms or existing content label that are already labeled either manually or by some analyst and so on. Thing that we are working on is to be able to support additional stream of data. So that means not only AIL to AIL, but for example, sending out to IntelliMQ and other tools that are existing in the CSIRT world to simplify the export stream of data so like that it's easier for other CSIRT to integrate the data. Another thing that we are working on is to basically improve indexing based on pre-classifications. Maybe we'll quickly show the synchronization later, but the synchronization is a two-step process where you have first classification schemes, then you can send it to the synchronization things. But what we want to do is to basically use the same model to send it, for example, in some cases to other indexers like OpenSearch, Solr, Lucene, or whatever you name it. So like that, we can have additional full text search on specific classified data or labeled data that you can have on the system. Okay, maybe for the synchronization aspect and the export stream, maybe Jean-Louis can do a quick demonstration of the synchronizations configurations. An example of Schenk, and then we can take some I would say time if you have any questions or things that we can discuss all together regarding that, because usually what we do is a kind of open workshop, so depending of the contribution of the different members there of what people are actually doing, if people are already using AIL or if they plan to use it, and what kind of usage they want to do.
Let me check.
Yeah, just to show how the synchronization works with the filtering with the specific tags. So I got. So this one is a pretty new feature of AIL. It's the ability to synchronize AIL instances. So it's quite similar to what we do in MISP for synchronizations, but there is more to stream the data. Ah, yes, very good question. So. Fidel has a good question about how AIL and IntelliMQ may work together. So when Jean-Louis is sharing his screen, he will show the two-step process of synchronizations. If you can share your screen. So like that, we can show the two-step of...
Yes, just 1 second, because I don't have the right... Preview. Why?
Sharing screen is always an issue. That's great.
Yes, you see it now?
Yeah, I see it. That's
perfect. Okay, so it's not the right screen. Too many screens. So let me check. Okay, good.
At the same time, I will explain what he's showing. So just for you. Quite interesting is Jean-Louis is basically running L into LX container, LXC container. So you can run it in that way. So he's running it on two containers. So for test and so on. So you, that means if you want to test L, you don't need a complete full-blown installations. But what you can do is basically run your own instance. Now it's connecting to the web interface of this L instance. And you will show the synchronization. So you have two instances, if I understand correctly.
Yes. Oh. So you have this one here. Like, I don't know if you see anything actually. But so this one is the one receiving data. And this one here is the one sending data.
Maybe you can increase the screen size.
Oop.
Wonderful. Thanks.
This one too. OK. And so if you go into server management, Async servers. Here you can add another server. So this one is already added. So I can show you how it's done here in edit. So you have a WebSocket, so a secure WebSocket connection that is done on the 4443 port. And you have to check this box here, push on both sides, because you will have to do this on both sides. And you have to agree on a server key. So here the server key is this one. If I go on the other server, here you see it's the same key. So this one is the 198 talking to the 35. And in the other way, it's 35 talking to the 198. So if I go back into the server list, then async, no, server list. OK, I click on it. Here I can see that they can talk to each other. So I can here, for instance, clear on version here. So it actually reaching the other server to see if they can talk to each other. This version here. Now what you need from the pushing side is a sync queue. So you have here a tab sync queues. So here I already created one. So if I go and edit it, it's the same as adding it, basically the form. So you can define how many elements you will have in the queue, the name of the queue, and you can actually say which element will go into this queue. So on the other server, you filter this by tags. So for instance, I can here choose to send everything that is automatically detected as an onion hidden service. So now what happens is that if I submit or if some item reaches this instance and it's automatically detected as an onion, it will then be sent to the other instance through the WebSocket. And this guy will be able to reach it here. So he will be able to search for these new items.
Yeah, so it's a two-step process. So it's one, you have to create a queue, which is basically based on the tags of the information that you want to send. And this tag is associated to a synchronization.
It can be one or multiple tag.
Okay.
And the idea of having multiple synchronization queue is that you can send multiple data to the other instance.
So you can have multiple queue depending on what you detect and so on.
Yeah.
Okay. So to answer the question that we have in the chat from Fidel, which is a good question regarding how future IntelliNQ integration might work, it means it will be similar. So in one way, we still have sync queue, which doesn't change, but we have a synchronizations, which should not be async, but IntelliNQ sync, for example, where we send the data matching this specific queue. That's correct, Aurélien?
Yep.
Okay, cool. And then regarding the Cerebral integrations, that's another thing. The first one that we see is for at least personally for us at Circle is really the sharing groups. So to be able to populate from Cerebrate in L the different sharing. Yes. If you have any questions, don't hesitate. Maybe Sami, you want to talk about the potential integrations with Cerebrate?
So I hope we'll not have feedbacks because a lot of people in the room have their mic open. So thanks. So basically, we'll integrate, as Alexandre said, sharing group information. But what we also would like to integrate is the interconnectivity of L instances together. So if you register in your Cerebrate two L instances, well, actually one L instances, and then you have a connectivity with another Cerebrate that already has L instance registered to it, you will be able via Cerebrate to interconnect the two L instances by just clicking two buttons, basically. So similar to what we have in MISP, for MISP actually, but that time for L. So automatically, it would create the different queues that Aurélien and Jean-Louis showed, and interconnect the two instances so that they can speak together. But for that, we need to have the API documentation for that, and also to finalize the MISP integration, because there are still some points that we can still improve for that. But we are already thinking about it and how we can do it, and it's absolutely feasible. So I will not commit on a like deadline for that, but it's foreseen and it will be done this year. That's for sure.
Yeah, for sure. So it's basically depend of Aurélien documentation of the API.
That's great. The API already exists, just the documentation.
Okay, great. So that's basically it for the introductions of L and so on. So now I would say I open the floor to everyone here for any additional questions regarding L and so on. Even idea, so how you are dealing with leak detections and so on. So L is really at the border or bridge with all those wild internet, Tor, hidden services, dark web, and so on to do the detection. So I understand that for some sort, it's something that they are already doing. For some, it's something completely new. So if you want to discuss now, I mean, the team in charge of L is there. So feel free to ask questions and so on. I might stop the recording now if you want. So like that, you can talk freely about your setup and so on. So I will do it even immediately.